Since 1958, when the Pies won their 13th premiership, they've played in 9 grand finals for a net return of 1 draw and 8 losses.
I mean, these are a club that hadn't won a premiership since 1958. They're back in there with a chance with not a great side. How hungry are you? How desperate and what's your desire like?
After all those many years, it's just raw emotion.
This was built up as a massive game.
After having all the heartache, I was so scared.
I hated them as a football club more than anything.
He knew I was coming in behind him, so we shaped up.
Thinking to myself, oh no, yeah, don't tell me.
Just went really quiet. It was the most eerie thing I've ever experienced.
Just felt so gutted by the whole thing. And it's something that still troubles you.
Never forget it and miss him deeply to this day.
You know, you think, gee whiz, I was that close.
We want to win this grand final, keep our eyes on the ball and be the victims.
This is it. Emotional scenes at the MCG.
They need to make something here. Langdon, the snap is good. What an amazing finish to the qualifying final.
We finish on top of the ladder and we travelled out to Waverley in a bus and see Collingwood versus West Coast in that first final.
It was a really tight game and somebody said, look, let's skip back to the car park and hop in the bus and we'll listen to the final bit of the game.
At that stage, we thought West Coast were going to win.
Back to Mullane, likewise. Dacos nearly runs out of room. He scores! Hoisted high. Back goes Simmons and he's taken the mark. I don't think the Eagles can lose from here. It's a question of whether they can win.
Peter Sumich had the ball. The Eagles were a point behind. Out of our control then.
I remember Guy McKenna played on me and at the very end of the game. I said, what happens now? We play extra time. And he said, no, I'll see you next week. And I thought, God.
Well, there was deathly silence in the bus.
What does that mean to us? And of course, it meant that we had another week off.
Well, morale wasn't that good. The fact that we weren't going to play again was a little bit disturbing, really.
It was a mental challenge and a mental hurdle, I think, from that point on.
We had no idea that that September would turn out to be the longest September in football history.
Collingwood's aggression on Saturday steamrolled the Eagles, and with Essendon raring to go after the prolonged layoff, we're certain to see a very lively first quarter on Sunday.
We're so pumped to play the Bombers at the G. That was a cracking game, and I think once we beat them, we're gone. Here we go. We're in real chance.
There's the siren. The Magpies are in the grand final for the first time since 81. Collingwood, an absolute thrashing of the minor premiers.
That was the year we got the week off. They qualified for the grand final in the second semi.
We went and watched Essendon play out at Waverley. They played the West Coast, of course, and beat them. And Lee had organised for us to go down, I think it was the Peninsula Golf Club down on the beach.
Sort of take it easy. Well, we lobbed down there and Banksy, Mullane, Krasiska, Wright, myself, they said, right, we're out. I said, boys, we can't get out. The door's locked after you go out. So they tied a sock around the door handle. So they went out.
Look, a couple of the blokes went back to the city. I didn't go there.
They went to every joint in Frankston. 21st century, you go downstairs, they're all had a heap, and they just get on the banister and they slide down the banister. And, of course, at the end of the banister, this massive ball. Bang, hits Krasiska in the leg and gives him this massive corky. So they're all drinking, get up the next morning. They get home with an hour to spare.
They did get caught out. We decided that they had to pay a price, so they did a fair bit of extra training and I think a couple of them got fined.
Phone started ringing and Lisa, I said, how'd it go, Lee? He said, oh, my God.
Yeah, they did the wrong thing.
Gav's hobbling around. He said, Doc said, you weren't hobbling around the other. No, I just got a bit of a corky from the week before. So the boys are out there pre-lim. Wait, imagine that now.
As the Bombers hit the track, the spectators made their allegiances clear.
They were massive build-ups, arguably the two biggest clubs in Victoria. This was built up as a massive game.
The training was terrible, like, and it was flat, you know. And I had a real bad feeling about that training session. It was just wrong how much we were fumbling. We just weren't sharp. We didn't have the right mood and vibe about the group. So I was anxious all the way through those couple of days. I was anxious about how we were going to perform on grand final day.
Brian Taylor, he's toiled and kicked goals for you over a decade of football, and you've dropped him.
He's got worse knees than you have.
Well, he played the first final. I mean, he'd only played a handful of games in 1990. His knee was shot, really. I mean, he was a football cripple.
And he was hobbling. Brian wasn't at his best, but Brian at his best was absolutely in the side.
Follow your gut, and the gut feeling was that he physically wasn't going to be what we needed.
Estimates on the crowd vary. Players were sharp, efficient and full of beans. In fact, there was barely a fumble or foul-up by anyone, as you'd half expect on Grand Final Eve. Keenest to impress were Alan Richardson, marginalised by shoulder problems. Keen to impress too, the players in line to replace him, Ron McEwen and Shane Kerrison.
Well, Alan Richardson broke his collarbone in the second semi-final.
Up the ground by Kelly was good play. Richardson.
Initially, there was a bit of resignation that probably only lasted perhaps the rest of that day. And then just, no, this is not going to happen. I'm going to do whatever I can to get myself right.
Well, it looks like he'll be OK. I must admit, it's a bit of a surprise to me. I thought last week he was sort of no chance, but he's done much better this week than I certainly thought.
I was doing all the training without the combative part of training, and I was convinced myself that I was right to go.
I was always going to put him through a pretty brutal fitness test.
So I was a little bit unlucky there because he was not that long out of the game. He was an incredibly powerful man.
15, 20,000 people watching this go down. And he sort of relaxed, and Lee knew he'd relax, and then Lee just went bang.
Basically just ran through me, ran over the top of me.
I remember at the time thinking, gee, that's a bit harsh.
It had to be done. Had to be done.
At the time, because I was just on incredible adrenaline trying to prove that I was fit to play in, you know, this massive game for a kid that had barracked for the Collingwood Footy Club all his life. And I ran off thinking, gee, I'm a chance here. Woke up in the morning, I'm in a lot of pain. I'd semi-knitted, if you like, in the fracture in the collarbone, and Lee had made amends to that.
He put his hand up and said, we won't worry about a Friday fitness test. I know I'm not right.
You think, gee whiz, I was that close. That was a tough time.
I fell for Alan Richardson, but we had to make some brutal decisions to make sure that we didn't fail.
The grand final parade is one of those pre-match commitments that the guests of honour would prefer had never been invented.
I guess most players would rather be sort of at home now, but it's part of the build-up.
I didn't want to be there. I mean, the last place I ever wanted to be was in that grand final parade.
Friday. Parade. What a shambles. What a total mess for the Essendon Footy Club that day. But I think we waited between 1 and 2 hours for our bus to arrive to pick us up that afternoon.
Then we all went out to Flemington Racecourse.
To be received at a football club dinner. I don't think you should have players at a function the night before a grand final. I get home at 10 p.m, you know, something like that. And it's not ideal.
Oh, I took Braden down the parade, my son. I looked down, he's bawling his eyes out. I said, mate, what's going on? And he goes, Dad, I just dropped my Ninja Turtle. Anyway, I look back, and about three cars back, I see this Ninja Turtle on the side of the road. So I thought, will I do it? So I jumped out, and the bloody car wheel rolls over it and smashes it. And he just bawled his eye out. So we get to the dais, and Mike Williamson was the compere. So I said to Mike, give me 5 minutes. So I ran in the Myers. I bought a Ninja Turtle. I come back, and I give it to him, and he's still bawling because I got the wrong one. I thought, oh, this isn't the greatest build-up we're ever going to have, Friday Grand Final.
Collingwood and Essendon, between them, have won 27 premierships. But this is their first grand final battle in 80 years. Under Kevin Sheedy, the Bombers won 2 premierships in the 80s. Their 1985 team is one of the greatest. Collingwood's misfortune in grand finals is a part of football folklore. This is football's most celebrated day, when one team triumphs, and today more than ever, it is an emotional occasion.
Subjectively, I must say, after 32 years, I don't think any club more deserves it than Collingwood.
For a legion of grand final starved Collingwood fans, it was a chance to throw off the Collywobble curse.
The Collywobbles, you'd get to the finals and then you would play poorly when it mattered.
It really hung over you, hung over all the supporters.
Yeah, the Collywobbles are alive and well. The nervousness, the tension surrounding a possible grand final defeat.
There was no doubt that that was in the back of everyone's mind.
Collywobbles, even in October.
We played on that as a club, and we made sure that we could unnerve Collingwood whenever we could, knowing that they'd had that history in the past.
Almost 100,000 people in at the cricket ground today.
In the past, if you went into a Collingwood grand final room, there'd be black and white and like a kid's birthday party everywhere.
I thought there'd be, you know, streamers and balloons and it was nothing. There was nothing.
Any thought that you have to motivate, hype up, get the adrenaline flowing in your players is patently ridiculous. If the occasion doesn't do that, they're dead. So I always tried to make the dressing rooms as low-key as possible.
The big news so far is that Shane Kerrison is stripped and will be playing for Collingwood today.
Ronnie McEwen has missed out. He'll be disappointed personally.
There's always going to be the player or two that just misses out. I'm pretty callous about it.
For Collingwood, just three of their players have played in a grand final. Banks in 79. And then after him, Dacos and Tony Shaw.
Shaw got up and he looked his teammates in the eyes as captain and said, I played in two losing grand finals and I'm not playing in a third.
I knew when I saw the Collingwood Football Club take the field. You could see it in their eyes.
It just looked like steely resolve. I think everybody had a belief that it was going to happen.
Just jam-packed in the roar. I got goosebumps.
They were convincing, and I would love that. You know, it was about, well, game on. I hated them as a football club more than anything.
Here come the Bombers.
You're moving through, but you're trying not to take notice of the magnitude of what it is that you're doing.
I remember vividly thinking before the game, looking at different players that were on.
Rather unashamedly felt that I could win this game. If it had to be on my own, I'd do it. The big game is when the big guys need to stand up.
Wasn't a great side, Collingwood, but their spirit was great and their hunger was great. I'm probably coaching a side that might have had players that have won premierships. And how hungry are you? How desperate and what's your desire like?
Minutes, it seemed to go on forever. We didn't score. Real concerns there, just because we had so much of the play.
Across the face, Salmon! Ripped all over. The football was Paul Salmon's name and he marks Salmon directly in front. Shoots for goal, it's close, it's home.
And a psychological blow for Essendon after Collingwood did so much attacking for no reward.
Sometimes you just have those days where, as a forward, you want to be on the end of it. And I was just begging the ball to come in.
And Christian now at centre-half back. Kelly on the forward pocket on Salmon.
The 200-centimetre forward, I mean, you can't have a defender who's tall enough to play him. And I sort of put Craig Kelly back.
He's gone to Salmon. Salmon is crucifying Collingwood.
Took a mark over my head and thought, that's not going to work.
Craig's just too small. It's Chris O'Neill. I just sent the message out to Chris O'Neill. OK, mate, back on the Salmon. Is yours for the day.
Salmon punts for goal. He's happy. It's there.
Thinking to myself, oh no, you know, don't tell me.
And the Magpies need a goal to find their feet. Dacos a rough chance here on the boundary line. Snaps it. Goal. Oh, no kidding. Yeah. The miracle man has done it. That was unbelievable. And just what Collingwood needed. They might talk about that like Jezelenko's mark.
Oh, great. Now we're going. Now we're in this.
And it gave me a massive lift, you know, to think, yeah, that's right, we've got this bloke on our side. Now we're a chance here, because he can do that.
The
The Magpies are settling. That is becoming clear. You can't blame them for being anxious early on. So much resting with them today. Stasevich can't mark. Brown drives the pack. In the pocket. Open goal. Goal. Magpies in front. In the shadows of quarter time.
Kick is wide. Over the head of Van der Haar. Makes good ground. Runs out of room. There's the siren. In the first term. In the 1990 grand final.
Typically, your grand finals, guys are pretty pumped up. You know, there's a niggle up in our forward line. I don't know what started it.
I could see that something was going to happen. Wasn't sure when. As history shows, the spark was lit, and it was lit close to quarter time.
It's quarter time in the grand final, and Bomber coach Kevin Sheedy is sprinting out to meet his charges. And oh, there's a fight on. In goes Kickett, and it's nasty.
I don't know what I was thinking, but anyway, I ankle tapped Spawn to let him know I was around. And all of a sudden, Spawn's into me, and that's how the brawl started.
I only saw the Spawn try and hit Banks. Well, that just, I went snap. And I ran, I reckon, about 30 metres, and I've just given, trying to give the biggest round arm, and I just missed him. I would have knocked his head off.
And then I've seen Redden run in, and I've gone and hit Kieran Spawn. TD's obviously gone in to fly the flag, as I did.
And he knew I was coming in behind him, so... be shaped up.
Oh, this is no Diggy Touchman. Oh! Collingwood player decked, but he hasn't moved.
That just jobbed him. He went down, but he wasn't supposed to stay down.
Just hit him with a really sweet one.
It was just like chaos. Well, so much anger, so much aggression.
You don't breathe. So anyone who says that fighting's good for you in a game is ridiculous.
Disgraceful. Yes. This is a blot on the game. That's an absolute disgrace.
A lot of people say it's out of character, you know, for me to take that type of action, but you haven't got too much time to think about the pros and cons of it when you're in that position. I'm glad I stood up, you know, for my teammate, and that's all I worry about.
Yeah, it goes, you know, I was of that belief. Things have changed now, obviously, but back then that was the way it was. And I've got no qualms. I have enormous respect for TD.
We love Terry Denner, and he's just one of the most beautiful guys you'll ever meet. Equally, Magpies love Brownie. And, yeah, so it didn't help. Didn't help.
Now, I think the real key to this game is who is going to settle down, because the emotions are really... Everybody has lost control of this game.
And I remember Lee, he grabbed me and he looked at me and he said my eyes were just rolling in the back of my head as if I wanted to kill someone.
They're puffing and blowing and their eyes are flaring. That's what the players look like. You had to try and calm them back down.
We wanted redemption. Don't ask me what Lee said, I wouldn't know.
And the thing that I wanted the most is I wanted to see their eyes. I wanted to make sure that I had their attention. We want to win this grand final. We're going to keep our eyes on the ball and be the victims.
Just totally focused on making us commit to each other that we're not going to go the man. Really important moment.
Sheeds did exactly the same thing to us. In first, the umpires want to pay free kicks. You've got to be there to win them. It appears in retrospect that both huddles are getting the same message.
Extraordinary scenes here at the end of that first quarter. I can tell you that Gavin Brown is going off the ground.
Comes clear. Kerrison goes down. McGuan gives a hand pass to Monkhorst, who's back for Brown. He puts Collingwood into attack. And Stasevich makes a very strong mark.
50.
Stasevich kicks and goals. Brzezinski has it. Inside 50. Goes for home and puts it back. The Magpies by 16 points and they are on a roll.
The hand pass to Izard. Russell's got him. He's lost it. Oh, 50 metres. That is stupid. Less than a rattle. Scott Russell. A gimme goal to send the Magpies further ahead.
And already that premiership is beckoning.
Russell's kicked a full forward. Oh, the mark for Sisko. Should be paid and will be. But he shoots from 20 metres out and pops it through. Up towards full forward. No mark, clutched away. Now Kickett gets his right for the ball. A miraculous goal by Kickett. And the
Russell plays on quickly. The centre forward's a player on his own. Bowie.
Yes, the siren's gone. Collingwood 8-9-57. Essendon 3-5-23. Coaching staff of both teams hurriedly leaving the arena. Lee Matthews hugging and embracing Gavin Brown, who missed the complete quarter after being KO'd.
As Lee Matthews makes his way up the race, Gavin Brown looked concussed.
He grabbed Gavin Brown, who was still half unconscious, held Brownie at the race until Terry came into their race. Lee grabbed Brownie's head and just whacked it into the wire and said, "The kid's coming back, Terry, you're too old."
"He'll be back, Terry, he'll be back to get you."
He was starting to get, "Oh, here we go again."
He was wild, like he had wild eyes, and he was just giving it to Terry, and profanities were just tumbling out of his mouth.
And Terry's throwing punches at Lee through the wire.
It was such an odd thing for a coach to engage in a verbal battle with a player on the opposition side.
And then when we got into the rooms, I said, "What'd you do that for?" He said, "Just to keep them anxious."
So here we go, the second half of the 1990 Grand Final.
Terry Danaher was running a muckham, and he had a day where he put on his boxing gloves instead of his footy boots.
They clearly went out wanting to go us. It was strange. It was strange.
Knocked out two players. It's just unusual. I don't know what got into him.
Coming in late and hitting players wasn't the right way to go about it at the time.
He doesn't look too good.
No, I don't think he's going to take the kick. Another player's got the ball.
Well, he's just got to come off the ground if he can't take his kick.
Mickey McGowan's going to take it.
Well, I was pretty happy about that because it's got us a 50-metre penalty. I was happy to sacrifice Stas getting knocked out to get Mick the goal that sort of put us 7 or 8 goals in front.
He kicks. He's done it. Well, they haven't had a better chance since 1970.
And the crowd can sense history being made here this afternoon.
I remember talking to Stas and someone said that we were talking a bit of gobbledygook. It was just a dream. I remember thinking, geez, I'm at a game of footy, but I'm actually watching the game. I'm not involved, I'm not playing. And it was all a little bit surreal.
Manson's going off and Brown's coming back on for Collingwood.
Listen to the roar for Gavin Brown. And he'll go down to Terry Danaher.
And I was pretty fired up.
Geez, what's he going to do here? You know, is he going to just go up and king hit Terry Danaher? What's going to happen?
Brown, naughty boy. Naughty boy fronting up to Danaher. You might get a whack in the gob. Brown is looking for trouble and he might get it.
Might have said he's going to bump me or I'll get you back, you bugger.
Well, spur of the moment, so I don't regret it. I look back and I sort of cringe a little bit.
And he is testing him, nose to nose.
The whole stadium lifted and all the players lifted, no doubt about that. It was a great moment.
Yeah, you know, I've taken your best punch. And, you know, I was out for a while, but I'm back.
The Bombers are going to have to do something if they are going to win this flag.
Dacos, look at him go. Mr. Magic has kicked the most unbelievable goal you have ever seen in a month of Sundays. Houdini, eat your heart out.
Well, the Bombers have kicked only 3 goals.
Time for Collingwood. They don't need this.
Grenbold, and he stabs at it, puts it through. Essendon get another one. And 2 quick goals to Essendon. They're still within striking distance, the Bombers.
Danaher versus Brown. Danaher makes the spoil. Roving for him is Thompson. Head pass to Brown.
That is the biggest gift of all time. That is like winning Tats Lotto, losing your ticket, and some bloke puts in the sum that he found it.
Collingwood have a commanding lead of 40 points. Mullane, the raging bull from Victoria Park. He's protected that thumb and he's done it well.
He broke it just before the finals, and I remember the doctors saying, look, he's out, he can't play. And he said, no, that's not true, I'm going
to
play.
When he did it, he came to train in plaster. They put it in plaster. He trained all week with plaster. I remember him cutting the plaster off match day, and just to see him sort of pull the thumb out of the gap in the plaster, you know, they'd inject it every quarter. Out in the ground at half time and three quarter time, they just inject it.
He would be re-breaking it every game.
Darren Mullane. Fair dinkum, he's as tough as rocking horse droppings, this boy.
All the players were suffering watching him go through each game and going through the whole week with the pain that he had to endure.
Playing with broken bones, well, I'll show you. And if you don't take notice, then I'll show you again. Now, not a lot of players are going to play. He had it. But his performance in his career was reckless with the cause.
Old Darren Mullane, a larrikin star of Aussie rules, lost his life suddenly at 10 to 3 this morning. He drove a car into the back of a semi-trailer in Albert Park.
Well, I got the phone call about 3 in the morning from the Victorian Police. Rang McAllister, the president, and we went down to the morgue. Still lives with me a fair bit.
Gubby Allen called me and told me that Darren had passed away, and I didn't believe that, so I just jumped in my car and I drove around to Craig Kelly's place where Pants would normally stay. Broke into the house, you know, because I thought he might have been sound asleep, so I broke in and satisfied myself that he wasn't there, and sort of reality was starting to sort of hit home at that point.
And then the name came over the radio, and I just sat there, I reckon, for probably about 30 minutes in my car.
And a reporter from the news rang me up, and she said, oh, so matter-of-factly, I'll never forget it. Oh, look, he died in a car accident last night. How old was he? And I'm thinking, you know, is this a joke?
It was surreal. I had to go and get his bag out of his car.
Hard to put into words.
There is no greater tragedy than the death of a young man in the prime of his life. Those who feel deeply will grieve deeply.
The fact that Matty was drunk and he drove. Luckily he drove, it didn't hurt someone else. I think he'd be the first person to say that too. I mean, he was the first person to say at times he was stupid.
This couldn't happen to him, but it did. Irrespective of who you are, you do the wrong thing, you're going to pay the price.
I thought he was bulletproof. I think a lot of people did. It would never happen to him, and it did. So it was such a tragedy.
We've got a trait about an Australian people that we don't tell people we love them until they're gone. It is a shame because if I could say to Darren now that I loved him, and I think the players would too.
It's education, it's continual education with young adults, especially males, that they do think they are bulletproof and that's not going to happen to them, but we all know that's not the case. You have to do the right things.
If ever there has been a launching pad where Collingwood will make history and win their first flag for 32 years, this is it.
Well, I've got a theory that Collingwood's collywobbles would appear if Essendon came at them in the last quarter.
They would be uncertain about the victory in a grand final, knowing that the club had a history of not necessarily winning grand finals. That was certainly mentioned by Kevin.
And you've got to work out how you can infiltrate their thinking and get quick goals, because the clock is ticking.
I'm so scared. To be a winner after having all the heartache,
you've got 25 minutes. You can feel it. It's in your hands. What's going to happen?
I reckon if Essendon could kick 2 or 3, they could send the fear of the Lord into 75,000 Collingwood supporters here at the MCG.
you're never home and hosed with guys like Kickett in their side.
A long kick up towards the forward line. Matt
kicks and hits the post. Well, that perhaps says it all.
High kick wide. Kickett and Tony Shaw. Shaw has been inspirational. Look at that. That is the story of Tony Shaw.
He was sort of like a wind-up doll that just kept going and going and going, and he was going to take his last breath on the MCG to make sure that they had victory on that day.
The Bombers are still trying desperately as they throw their bodies in.
And Collingwood defence standing up grandly. They've only given away 5 goals in 3.5 quarters of football.
Breaks to Shaw again. Gives it to Bowen, on to Banks, Dennis Banks, caught, back to Bowen, Doug Bowen, shoots, and goes,
isn't it a tired, isn't it a broken?
And to their credit, not one Collingwood player rejoiced. Such is their discipline that their minds are still on the job. They're making sure of it this year.
They know now, they know.
I remember standing next to Timmy and I said, Tim, you reckon we got you? And he sort of said, mate, I reckon he had us at half time.
Their heads were right down, and they were beavering away, and they didn't look up until the final siren sounded.
Anthony Danner, who's tried his heart out, Anthony Danner, all day.
Now, that is a great effort. He just kept his body over the ball. That was Kelly coming through, and that's indicative of the way that Collingwood have played.
Ned's got his head down, and he barrowed his head in the bloke's bottom of his knees, both knees. And I said, Ned, that's the reason we've got this grand final, and we're going to win it.
Sure, he's done. That's why we won, and That was towards the end of it. Didn't have much left.
And then the Collingwood supporters start singing their song. And so, there was nowhere to hide.
After 30-odd years of losing, it just went really quiet. And then the chant came up.
Said to me, we now can't lose. That's the moment.
This is it. Emotional scenes at the MCG. And there'll be a baby boom 9 months from tonight, you mark my words. And Logan Lee Matthews down on the boundary line. Hugging him is Graham Allen and Manson. What magnificent scenes here.
Lee Matthews and Alan McAllister embrace now. They've brought the flag back to Collingwood.
I'm not sure if I can call the last couple of minutes, Tim.
After all those many years, it's just a raw emotion.
It's just relief. We'd finally broken the shackles.
Mentally and physically, I was shot. I had nothing left.
Talking about the promised land, to all those Collingwood supporters who have passed on since 1958, God bless you all. Timmy Watson goes over and he and Tony Shaw embrace.
It was just inescapable how valuable his contribution was to Collingwood.
While we've looked at the winners, we must also think of the losers.
You've got to actually talk the truth to them and explain to them that, this may be your last time ever that you'll run onto the field in a grand final and walk off defeated.
He was looking at you to see how you were either accepting or not accepting of what had happened. It hurt. It hurt.
The Bombers very slowly and quietly, with dignity, leaving the MCG.
Just felt so gutted by the whole thing. And it's just like a stain. You feel like it's a stain on your career.
To this day, Collingwood people will remind you of the day that their club got back on the premiership agenda, and it was at our expense. And that's something that lives with us guys that played in that game, and Kevin, for the rest of our lives.
For much of that year, we were the best side in the competition. But when it mattered most, we weren't. It is something that still troubles you.
I'm not happy they won it. But if we were going to be beaten by somebody, I can cope with a club like Collingwood who turn up every year, year after year, with their fans buy memberships and really decent supporters for their club. And I can cope with that. Don't like it, but I can cope with it.
32 years, and they've now won the first premiership under the new AFL banner. Congratulations. The winner of the Norm Smith Medal, surprisingly, Tony Shaw.
I thought I had a fair game, but I thought Scotty Russell was brilliant. And I thought Monkey was fantastic for such a youngster in a game like that.
Can't run, can't kick, can't handball, but just an inspiration.
I kept swearing. He said, "Shut up and talk properly." I said, "I can't. It's fantastic." So beep, 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 beep. He couldn't use any of it.
How ironic, all the jokes made about Collingwood for so long that they win the first AFL premiership. It is fantastic for the club. And now I know one happy man, this Tony Shaw, being greeted by his wife.
Their performances over the finals just first class. They really were.
Ronnie McEwen, I feel for him a bit at the moment, don't you?
Hello, Richardson.
It's bad luck for myself, but it's the main thing is we won the grand final. That's it.
You know, I go up with this incredibly enthusiastic embrace of a teammate. Whilst there was certainly the embrace back, it was an empathetic brace back. It was a, "Geez, I'm disappointed for you" embrace back. Emotionally, it makes it worse because then you start to feel even more sorry for yourself.
I try to think myself sometimes, if it had been me, I don't know whether I would have been able to display those emotions that he was able to display. And they were real emotions of happiness for everyone. I would have struggled a bit with the whole thing. Yeah, I would have probably gone a bit insular.
Walking to the car park afterwards, and I was going across the concourse at MCG to the car and bumped into Tony Shaw. At that moment, I had this really weird feeling. I felt happy for him. You know, he was a prick of a bloke to play against, but a good guy, and I felt pleased that Shaw had that experience.
For him to come up and say, "Well done," and, you know, congratulate me on what happened, it's a class act.
2 minutes later, I'm sitting in my car, banging the steering wheel.
Takes us hours to get from the Southern Cross to Victoria Park because the bus was just gridlocked. It was bizarre. You know, imagine that happening now. It just wouldn't happen. For me to go home, I've got to drive through Collingwood. Look, hey, good luck.
It was just an amazing scene. The whole ground was just packed with people and we all got up on stage. It was just a sea of people and a sea of joy. Yeah, well, you felt like a rock star.
You can appreciate what serious rock stars must feel like.
As good as a night you'll ever get. It was like being in heaven.
I don't think we stopped for 4 days. It was a good sip.
As the siren must only be seconds away. Smooth, do you want the last few seconds?
OK, Tim. Halfback flag, Collingwood.
Darren Lane holding the ball up just typified Collingwood in 1990.
I think he deserved that moment in time because of, and it's so appropriate that he finish up with it.
Given the events that unfolded post, it's pretty significant. It's quite amazing, really, that happened.
I have dreams about him. I'd wake up often having a dream about Pants and I playing together. It's weird, as if it's right still there, and I often think he must be still around, but that's, you know, that's, I suppose, those of us that have been touched with that sort of stuff, you sort of often think they're pretty close to you.
The Milano family, you know, I speak to Denise not as often as I probably should, but we do catch up every so often. A link with Denise and Sean and John keeps a link with Darren. A long grieving there for me. I never forget it and miss him deeply to this day.
I remember my dad, who didn't want to see him before the game, said, "I don't want to see you. I've got to get our head around this thing, and I'll see you after the game." Anyway, he got to Victoria Park, and I remember trying to work through this mass to get to the stage. And I could see these people saying, push out the road. This big man, the old man, 6'3", 6'4". And then he's come through and that was pretty emotional. I see it now. I've got three boys and amazing thing to see your sons play footy, let alone win a flag. Anyone who gets a chance to play this game of footy, to stand out there with your mates in the most amazing coliseum in the world. Being in the middle of that, doing your job and being part of Collingwood is just spine-tingling.
It makes me feel really proud, and it makes me feel like that I've really accomplished something really significant.
Every year that there's another group of players that go up and you think, gee whiz, I was that close. It's probably driven me to try and help others achieve that goal.
I played with a few of them, I recruited most of them. I love them.
The fact that I was able to spend a decade of my life at Collingwood is one of the great pleasures of my existence.
I look at it that I'm perceived as a winner.
Collingwood today have done themselves, their families and the Collingwood throng a great service by finally burying the 1958 myth that has carried them into seven losing grand finals prior to this magical day, the 6th of October, 1990.